Good morning, welcome today. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. We invite you, if you haven't already received one of the bulletins as you came in, they're actually information papers. It's a good tool you can take with you when you leave this place that you can share with others of what's happening in the life of Baptist Temple and what is happening on this campus, because lots of things are happening all the time. But that's a tool for you to take with you to share with those around you. Also, there's a communication card that's available there. And if you didn't receive it on the way in, you can also get it on the way out. But you could, or you can go get it right now. That would be fine. We use that so that we know that you have a prayer need or you have something that you'd like us to be aware of. And you can just place that in the offering plate as it goes by. Today is a wonderful, special day because today we get to celebrate the ordinance of the Lord's Supper. And it's a time to reflect and to connect with the true meaning of communion, which is connection. We're all creations of God. We are all connected to each other because God created your neighbor just like he created you. And he created us so that we could have that connection with him, so that we could be a family in eternity and in perfection, in his perfection. And this plan of his is reflected in the grace of his son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins, for the things that we have done to destroy a connection with God who is perfect, but to take our sins upon himself so that we might actually be able to fellowship and receive the love of God and the forgiveness of God and the connection and the family of God. And so that's what this is about. It's a reminder of Jesus on the cross and his blood that was shed for your sins. And it's a time that we can share with each other. So we invite those of you who have accepted Jesus Christ into their lives to be a part of this service as well. And if you haven't done that, I mean, you're take a look and see what it is that we're talking about, because we love to share with you what God has done in our lives and what a difference he makes. So we invite you to worship today, and we invite you to commune with us today. We're part of God's family. God inhabits the spaces between us, which is a wonderful idea, and connects us together. He is our creator, and we worship him in this time and this place. Would you bow with me as we go to him in prayer? Dear Lord, we thank you that you created time and space itself. You created everything that we see around us, all the physical elements that communicate beauty or nature, that are all around us, they're reminders of your magnificent hand and the scope of who you are. Lord, I thank you that you are this person, and even as mighty and powerful as you are, you still know the intimate thoughts in our mind. You know every hair on our head. You know every concern in our heart. You know when we're hurting. You created us. I thank you that that is also who you are. Lord, I thank you that you created love, that you created every aspect of what we know. And I pray, Lord, that you would inhabit this space today with your presence, with your love, with your power, to connect all of us together in love and forgiveness, in mission. Thank you for who you are. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you stand once again as we join together and as we sing together once again, Great Grace Greater Than Our Sin. Marvelous grace, my loving Lord.
Good morning, everybody.
Yep.
Now, let me start today with a word of prayer. Dear Lord, we thank you this morning for all the blessings you give us, for the instruction, and for the fact and the privilege to be used by you, to be called your children. Let us learn and let us be formed by your hands, and let us be used as your tools for the creation and for the growth of your kingdom. These things we pray in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right. So, this is the third time I preach over here with y'all, and I love it. One second, y'all. Come on.
Let's be.
Yeah, it is an honor to come before you and preach, and I love it because this is the only way, the only thing that I can think of that I get to have my cake and to eat it too. So when I'm saying that, I mean that when you study the Bible, that's the only example I have, that you get to eat cake, the wonderful privilege that is to study the Bible, and you get to have it because you keep on going back to the Word. You'll find more cake and more cake and more cake than you can ever eat, you know? So I encourage you to study the words and read the Bible and to eat it and to enjoy it, because that's a blessing and a cake that the Lord has made for you. So that's why I like preaching so much. So let me ask you an interesting question, and I'd like you all to participate if you like. Have you ever gone tubing here in San Antonio, Texas? I love going tubing in New Braunfels. Have you ever gone tubing? Have you ever floated downstream? Any of y'all?
Yeah.
Have you ever floated upstream? You know that?
Yeah,
I haven't seen that either. You know? The natural way of things to go is downwards. We call that gravity. Okay? So let me read you today's verse. The path of life leads upward for the prudent, to keep them from going down to the realm of the dead. Other translations have it as hell or Sheol. Okay? How much work does it take to fall down and roll downhill? No work at all, right? Happens to me all the time. Think I did something. Sorry. I got it. How much work does it take to stop that and
have
again? No. I'm sorry. Sorry, y'all.
Testing?
Is it working?
Yes. Yeah.
Alright. Thank you. You're so professional now. Okay, so if you fall down, if you fall down and you start rolling down, how hard is it to stop? Sometimes it takes you to get, you know, a good hit against a tree, against a rock, and that's the only way you get to stop, right? How hard is to walk up a hill in comparison to walking down? You know, it's very easy when you're walking down a hill, just keep walking. You don't feel like you're doing any effort because the gravity is helping you so much. But when you're going uphill, especially if you go like on a bike, especially, man, it's a lot more work, okay? So, things which are good for you are always like a walk uphill. They're always higher. They take some work. They take some sweat. You know? Those things are good for you. I'm talking about working and studying the Word. Those things take a lot of effort. But they're good for you. The Lord wants you to work, to put some effort, to be, what's the word? Or to be diligent, to be disciplined. So, that's why for the wise, things always lead up, because that's what God wants for us. This includes your personal life, your family life, your career. With the blessing of God and His instructions, we can only go higher and higher and closer to the Lord, you know? Like it says here in the verse, the path of life leads for the prudent, for the wise, upward. For the unwise, it is to hell, okay? So it's very easy, it's a natural way things to go, for it to go down. For it to, if you ease, if you relax, if you're very comfortable, you will not realize it, but you'll be floating downstream. You will be sitting on the floaty of life in that river, and you'll be floating downstream, you know, and it will take you down closer to Sheol, to hell. So what I'm trying to say is that comfort sometimes can lead us to away from the Lord, can lead us down instead of up the hill. Because when I think of the hill of our life and our journey with the Lord, I think of the top, the very pinnacle, as being Jesus Christ. That's the highest a man, I mean, when Christ is on earth, that's the highest a man can ever be. No man can top Christ. No man can be as good or as high. But I sure want to walk up the hill and get a little closer, okay? It's tough. It's tough. Nobody can get to the top. And the higher you get, the more, you know, gets colder, the air is thinner. It's hard to climb that hill. I think we should all want to climb that hill, get closer to God. Closer to the Lord, get to know Him, okay? So things which are better are always like a walk uphill. Because that's what God wants for us. We will never top Christ, that's what I just said. So what is the fastest way for y'all to do, how do you call it? Mountain climbing, or when you do like a trek, a walk up the mountain. What is the fastest and the correct way to go up to the top of the mountain?
One step at a time.
One step at a time? What about the way? How do you call like the best path? The trail, right? Is there any other way to get to the top? There are other ways to get to the top.
A helicopter?
You gotta have money for that one. That's not me. But in when it comes to the hill of our journey with the Lord, there is no helicopter. You can only go up a number of ways, okay? Some people like to go the right way, the correct way is the trail, okay? That's the easy, I mean, it's not easy, but it's still the most proper way to go. But some people like to walk through the bushes. Some people get wander around the way and they get hurt and they scratch themselves with the brushes and to the wilderness. And some people need that. Some people need to get, it's hard, it's not because it's God's fault, but some people, stubborn people, need to get hurt and humble for them to come back to the Lord. That's what some people need, okay? That's not for everybody. So people can walk and wander outside the trail and try to get to the top and get lost, and hopefully one day, going up, they'll find a way back. We see that a lot here at church. People lose their way trying to get to the top, trying to be more like Christ, trying to be more in connection with the Lord, and they get lost at some point. They take a wrong turn and they get lost in the wilderness, and they keep on trying to find a way to go up, right? And it's gonna hurt a little more. There's some other people that they're ashamed. They're ashamed of who they are, what they've done. But we all need to take that journey. That journey is not an option. You're either going up or down. So when you're ashamed, people try to hide. So they try to crawl up that mountain. And it's so much harder to crawl because of shame or because of fear, okay? We need to let go of that, of course. Some people like to pack extra weight, you know? They put a weighted vest, you know, a backpack, because they want to prove the world that they're so much stronger and they're so good. And it gets more difficult to them too, because the journey with the Lord is not a race. It's never been a competition. So We like to make ourselves, some people, we like to make ourselves more difficult to get to the top. And that's not what the Lord wants for us. Lord, God always wants to lead us higher, for us to be to succeed in our life, as not in an economically based, but to succeed in the path that He has given for us. You know, God has made a path for each one of us, and He knows us better than nobody ever will. So He has a path for you, and for me, and for your neighbor, and for your loved ones. And you just have to follow it, and it will always lead up. So, it's gonna be hard, okay? You're gonna find some obstacles, you're gonna find a lot of things in the way, but this work will make you stronger. It will make you get closer to all these obstacles, okay? I was thinking about earlier about a story of my life. I'm a pastor's kid, okay? And pastor's kids have a reputation for being rowdy ones, for being pranksters and all that. And that was me, guys. That was me, okay? I remember one time we were at a church camp, and I was the pastor's son. So when we met the farm owner, the camp owner, I was with my dad, and he saw me, and me and the guy were playing this prank. Okay, at 5 in the morning, we get out and I see the cab owner's son, and he is like, he's like walking a cow, he's taking the cow somewhere. And I go, hey, the pastor wants me to ask you if we can please move the cow to a special location. And the guy goes, okay, sure. So we do take the cow to a special location. But he didn't know that that special location was the hallway in the girls' camp house. So we walked the cow in backwards, and it's blocking the hallway. And this is like at 5 in the morning, so we close the door, and the cow gets stuck in there, you know? Interestingly enough, it took like 2 hours for the girls to freak out inside and realize that there was a cow blocking the only exit. So what I'm trying to get here with my point is there was two kinds of people in my church. There were the people who knew me and knew that I was like so rowdy and so little and evil. No, let me tell you again. There were people who knew me. I was the pastor's son, okay? So they couldn't believe that I could be evil and rambunctious and all of that stuff. Okay, that was the first kind of people. And the other kind of people were the people who knew me, and they knew I was rambunctious and evil, and they couldn't believe I was the pastor's son. Meaning that what I'm trying to get across with this message is that the Lord wants us to go higher, and that higher attitude takes difficulties, takes toll on your body. And sometimes you try to find your own way, you try to stray away from the way that the Lord has planned for you. And you're gonna get hurt, you're gonna get humble, and you're gonna go through the mud. But eventually, if you're obedient enough, you have to go back. And like I was saying, some of us like to take extra equipment, you know, be extra flashy with your stuff, take our extra gear to show others that I'm so strong. I'm such a strong believer that I'm gonna do this my way with my own strength. And that's not the way we're supposed to do things. Because we're supposed to do things through God who strengthens us, okay? Sometimes we're in fear and in shame because of what we have done, because of our life. And we want to crawl because we don't want nobody to see us. We're ashamed. But when we're ashamed like that and we try to crawl, we don't get any higher. It's so tough to climb. If it's tough to walk up a hill, try to crawl it up. It's that much more difficult. But no matter the obstacles, no matter, there's not an option. God wants you to go higher up that hill, to get closer to Him. But not only you, but your family, your loved ones, your friends, because you know the way to the top, and they're lost. They're lost out in the wilderness, and we are walking up a hill. So it's up to us to go there and tell them, hey, this is the way up. This is the path. This is the trail. And when we get there, one day when we die and we get to heaven and we get to the top of the hill, we get to meet our Savior. Their blood, the Bible says that their blood will be in our hands because we didn't do enough, okay? Always walk uphill. It can be tiring. You might struggle. You might find some obstacles and rocks and walls and distractions on your journey. But as long as you follow the trail that the Lord has made for you, it will always lead upwards. It's going to be tough. But tough things, because something being hard and difficult doesn't make it the right thing. You know, don't do things just because they're hard. I know it's kind of conflicting and contradicting with what I'm saying, but I'm saying that doing the right thing is tough. But not every tough thing is right. Like I was saying, people try to make it right and then they try to make it tough. I'm trying to make it tough. I'm going to go to the wilderness. I'm going to go to the bushes because I'm an adventurer. I'm an explorer. I'm going to prove that the way that I've been taught, I'm going to prove that the way that's in the Bible is not the only way. I'm going to prove that those people are wrong, and I'm going to walk and I'm going to show them. And you get lost. And you get hurt. And you make it extra hard for yourself. You're not helping nobody. So my sermon today, my goal of my sermon today, was to encourage us, encourage you and myself even, that sometimes life struggles are a sign that you're walking up the hill. If you don't have too many struggles, guys, you gotta check your surroundings. Maybe you're going down. Maybe you're just sliding down real fast. And the faster you go down, the harder is gonna be the hit that's gonna take you to stop. Okay? Lord wants us to be higher, close to Him, to be in a better relationship with Him. And we get to see Him more. The closer we get to listen to Him more. We get to know His voice. Because if we don't know His voice, when He calls us, we won't hear it. You know? Like when you're in a crowd and your mom yells out your name, you hear it because you know her voice. But if you don't know the Lord's voice, you will never recognize Him in the crowd of voices that you will hear along the path. So this is my suggestion, and this is what the Bible says to you. The path of life leads upwards for the prudent, to keep them from going down to the realm of the dead, of hell. Brothers and sisters, always walk upwards. Always follow the path that the Lord has given to you. And while you are walking and doing that hike, look to your side and find who else is lost and who needs to find the path back to the top. Thank you very much. And yes, it's my sermon.
You'll like it.
I'd like to give you my arm. Can you hear me? Okay. Give you a bit of introduction. Our deacons will pass the plates to you. They're wearing gloves. They will hand you the grape juice and the bread, and so you won't have to touch anything other than take it from their hands. And with that, in 1 Corinthians 11:27, it reads, "Whoever eats the bread and drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and the blood of the Lord." So we should examine ourselves before eating the bread and drinking from the cup. So let us take a few moments now to pray silently, searching our hearts and seeking God's forgiveness for our sins. We confess to you, Lord, that we have not been everything that you would have us to be. We have not acknowledged your presence. We have looked for our own needs without thinking of others. For these and the sins that you see in our hearts, we ask you to forgive us. Turn us again to the things that matter. Let our commitment to you become fresh as we remember your sacrifice and celebrate your presence. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Will you bow with me in prayer? With this bread and this cup, we remember your Son, the firstborn of all creation. We remember his death and resurrection, and we await his return when, with the world reborn in him, we will share in the great feast. Amen. For I received from the Lord what I also pass on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night that he was betrayed, took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Thank you. the same way, after the supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." Whenever you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break in participation of the body of Christ? Because there is one loaf. We who are many are one body, for we partake of the one loaf. Afterwards they sang a hymn. We're going to sing "Blessed Be the Tide." Transcends all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen.